Thank you very much. Thanks for inviting me. And if I can just comment on a few things that were said. So Marshall, I'm new at this. And most of my fellow Mandarians are, and I'm sitting here listening to all of you and thinking, maybe I should just walk out, because I don't know what I'm going to add here, but I'm going to try. And I just want to say I'm here because my colleague, Senator White, could not be, and now I wish I hadn't agreed, but anyway. I will deal with him later. Cultural impact. In my previous life, I tried very hard to get judges to understand, especially within the South Asian community, the challenges of cultural norms. And I was always told, no, you can't influence us. We will make up our own minds. And so this is a great step. And I congratulate you. And I hope other jurisdictions are also looking at this. And I want to start off, in my remarks, and there'll be, I kept saying, yeah, but without resources, we cannot do this, but without resources, we cannot do it. And, when we came to Halifax and saw the great things you were doing, and I may be wrong, but we saw some other things in other provinces, it is just an add-on without not, you may have some resources, but in other provinces. So it's just like, especially resources of psychologists, psychiatrists, doctors, others, it's just more work you do without really, if you're going to have restorative justice, we're really going to have a process. Us parliamentarians have to make sure that there are resources. And so it's great to have all these programs, but in my, I could keep saying, but there haven't been any resources provided. So I think that when you talk about looking after the 90%, I'm not so sure, and I'm certainly willing to have. I know that I see some justice colleagues here, or some justice people here, who may say that I'm wrong. But I don't think with the 90% has come the 90% in resources, and I don't. I think we're still expecting the community to carry that burden. And that can just lead to difficulties. So I want to start my remarks, and I'm going to thank you. It's a real honor to be here for me. Jennifer said to me, I would have something to add, so I'm here. And if I'm not adding anything to this discussion, it's Jennifer's fault. Ways to find out about delays of court. One of the main things we heard is that the justice system is broken. Well, that's not anything new to you, but it wasn't new to us either. And when we started this study, I was the vice chair of the Constitutional Committee, and I was keen to do this study because one of the things that really bothers me is that in the previous, and I'm not trying to wear my liberal hat, but in the previous number of years that we had, we did a lot of mandatory sentencing. And with mandatory sentencing comes a lot of additional costs. And I was concerned how was it leading to more delays? How was it making it more difficult for prosecutors, defense counsel, and judges to do their jobs? And then, of course, we've had the Jordan decision, which I'm sure most of you know. It's a decision that said that we cannot have unreasonable delays. So the committee started its work in January 26, and we took on a study on matters pertaining to delays in Canada's criminal justice system and to review the roles of Government of Canada and Parliament in addressing such delays. And we have an interim report. Obviously, I cannot go through it with you today, but I have brought some copies, and of course, we have some online. And one of the things that we were not looking at restorative justice. That's not what we were looking at. We were looking at the 10%, but it has led us to look at alternative ways looking at alternative ways to deal with the thing about the issue of trial delays. And we heard from many people. We heard from all across the country. We heard from people that the system is overburdened, a system that is losing, not gaining ground, a justice system that cannot keep up, a system that is becoming more backlogged, a system that finds overrepresented groups, a system that is primarily housing those with mental illness or addictions in a system in need of repair. And I'm sure you've always all heard this, that you know, Mr. Saffer, the Ombudsman of Correction, has often said to our legal committee that we have more people with mental health issues in prisons than we have in hospitals. And you know, how can that be correct? How can that be our Canada? A Canada that we value people, a Canada that we take so much pride, how can that be possible? So in the report, we have four recommendations. It's an interim report. And I want to say here to the Chief Judge, Chief Judge, you led the way. She spoke to us publicly, which is not done very often. And since she spoke publicly, some of her other colleagues may speak publicly to the committee. And that's really important, because if she speaks to us publicly, we can quote her. If she speaks to us privately, it's a private conversation. So she took some great risks for doing that, and we thank you for that. I said to Judge Crabtree, who is my judge in my province, that maybe we should borrow Judge Williams to come to our province.
No.
So the four recommendations we have is about case flow management, judicial appointments, technology, and restorative justice. And you know, when we started looking at this study, we really were wanting to see what solutions can we suggest? What can we suggest? And we were thinking maybe appointments of more judges, maybe resources, and yes, maybe that too, but it has to be more than that. It's how we look after the 90%. So we have looked at spousal violence courts, mental health courts, Aboriginal courts, drug courts, in my province we have a poverty court, and they're great courts, but you know what came up? Our chair kept asking, Senator Anselman kept asking this question. But this delays the process. It doesn't make the process any shorter. Because as you can understand, to work with special alternative ways, it delays the process. But I kept saying to him, but then we won't see them again. So it really hastens the process later. We deal with the person. And that's something us politicians and in the justice system, we have to realize is, when will we deal with the person rather than the number? So the one thing that I would like to say to you is that that's the challenge, is how do we deal with the person? And I can go on, I have lots to say on this, but what has already been said is we cannot look at all people being treated alike. We can't have a cookie-cut approach. You know, and when we went to Judge Williams' court, she made it so clear to us that she made it so clear to us that every person that came in front of her was first a human being that needed to be looked after. And that's not what the justice system is about, not the way we've set it up. So we have to have a complete mind change. And I respectfully say to you that the next conference you have, you should have half of the people that know, have your knowledge, and half of us to give us the knowledge. So together, we can look at how we look after the 90%, because until we, the people who don't understand these systems, do not know how to pass laws, provide resources for the 90%, we will always be doing this from the side of our table. Now, I have run out of my time, so I want to say something that Judge Williams said it, and we have somebody, Sue Sullivan, from the Federal Ombudsman for Victims of Crime. I think she must get tired of coming to our committee, because every time she comes to our committee shop, she speaks about the rights of victims, rights of victims. And I want to leave this one story, or one incident that haunts me, is that when there is a court delay, at the end of it, when that case is stayed, or the victim has forgotten the facts, we are re-victimizing the victim. And that's why court delays is wrong, and that is why we need alternate processes. But to us politicians, those alternate processes will only work if we provide resources for the 90%. And I will certainly take that message back. And I want to finish by saying that I've just come back from Sri Lanka. Last night, I work on issues of extremism, and everywhere I went, people talked about, and I don't know how they know this, because I didn't know this before, about what you all do here at restorative justice, and also of truth and reconciliation. You know, and so many women from all over the Muslim world were saying, how do we do truth and reconciliation? How do we do what you all just did in the state, in Canada? How do you do this? And you know, I was so amazed that people look or watch what we do. And so I'm saying to you, what you do here, people, not just in Canada will benefit, but outside benefit. And so let me tell you that. You know, Jennifer Loon's paper on from restorative process to talking about truth and reconciliation. So I have homework for you. All I would like you all to look at also, how do we then go to peace agreements? How do we look at then using the restorative process for peace agreements? Because it's so important that we put all those together because we are a small world. And when I was listening to this morning's presenters, and when I was preparing on the plane, I was thinking, you know, at the moment, the court process is a scissors. We truly cut up people's lives. And then we do not worry because our job is done. And then we leave them in society. What each and every one of you are doing, you are needles. You are sewing our society up. You're trying to make our society more cohesive. And I salute you for this, especially at a time when, let's not kid ourselves, what's happening in the South is not only happening in the South. Mm-hmm. I'm a Muslim woman. I could tell you a lot of stories of what's happening here in Canada too at the moment. Our societies are hurting. And as Just Barry said, there is a reason for that. We have to look at what we are doing. Us politicians and the justice system cuts up societies and then wonders why we are having the problem. I salute you because you sow our societies and keep us whole, try to keep us whole. Thank you very much.